Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neil Howard. Thank you so much for joining us for another segment. In this segment, we're going to be speaking with Dr. Antonia Chen. She's joining us here to discuss the recent surge in hospital site infections and surgical site infections as a result of the challenges related to COVID-19. She's also going to share her insights as a practicing orthopedic surgeon on why antibacterial sutures should be standard in every U.S. operating room and how advancements in wound closure are leading to the fight in saving cost and reducing SSI. Welcome to Health Professional Radio. Dr. Chen, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me. I greatly appreciate this opportunity to talk about an important topic and important area.
Well, orthopedic surgeon, give us a little bit of your professional background and talk about where you're currently practicing and in what capacity.
So I'm a hip and knee replacement surgeon at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. And I've been doing this for some time now, and most patients are very happy with their outcome. They get a brand new hip and a brand new knee, and they do well. But a small percentage of patients get infected, and they get surgical site infections, also abbreviated as SSIs. And in the context of hip and knee replacements, what's interesting is that in this context, if you get infected, it's not just an SSI. We actually call them periprosthetic joint infections, or the infections around the joint itself. And because of that, if you get this problem, you might have to take everything out of your knee or your hip, have no joint in you for 3 to 6 months, and then you go put it back in. So as you can imagine, we take SSIs or periprosthetic joint infections very seriously.
Now, I understand that there are almost 800,000 cases of SSI per year, and taking everything out of a hip or a knee and replacing it 6 months later, that is quite costly.
It's very costly. That's what makes it so difficult. It's not just one procedure, it's two procedures. And normally it's not just the patient. They have people helping them with their health care, including friends and family who may have to take off time from work, and the patient has to lose time from work also. So the cost of surgical site infections annually is between $3.5 to $10 billion.
Wow. Are most surgeons aware of the possibility of SSI?
Surgeons are aware of surgical site infections. That's the good news of it. How they prevent them, though, multiple people have different ways of preventing it. And it's nice to be able to educate surgeons as well as patients as to even more ways that they can do and implement into their practice to reduce their risk of becoming infected or having their patients become infected.
Were those two examples of the worst case scenario that you just shared, having to take all of the components out of a replaced hip or knee and reinserting it 6 months later, are those examples of the worst case scenario, or does it get even worse?
It unfortunately gets even worse, and I hate to say this, but there's mortality or death associated with it. So there have been studies looking at periprosthetic joint infection. So again, we're looking at the hip and knee replacements patient population, where there are more of these than there are some cancers, or increased amount of death from this than some cancers. You know, breast cancer has a death rate, but not as high as some other cancers. So there is more death associated with a joint infection than there is cancer, which is a scary thought. So, you know, it's one of those things where a surgical site infection increases the patient's likelihood of being admitted to a hospital by 50%, and it can double a patient's chance of death.
How much patient participation is involved in trying to prevent SSIs? Is this something that, you know, the patient has just undergone a surgical procedure, they're tired, they may be elderly? Is it all on the responsibility of the facility to prevent SSIs?
The nice thing about it is that it's a team effort. I would say the answer is no, it's not all just on the facility side, but you want to engage the patient as well as the surgeon and the surgical team. So from a patient perspective, I like patient optimization before surgery. So what does that mean? That means I want patients to be as healthy as possible to reduce their likelihood of becoming infected. So if they have things like diabetes or obesity, we try to optimize them or lower them and control them before surgery. Before surgery, I test patients for bacteria that could be on their nose and that subsequently could be on their skin. And if positive, I'll treat them. If not, though, I will still give them a bathing wash to use on their skin, because most of our infections, especially in the realm of orthopedics, but in surgery in general, come from the organisms that live on our skin naturally. So we want to clean them off prior to surgery, so it reduces the likelihood that the bacteria from your skin get into your body. And once they get into your body, your immune system normally fights them off and gets rid of them. But if your immune system is not at its best, then it can't fight it off as well. That's from the patient side of things. from the hospital side of things or from the surgeon side of things, we can do things as well too. So when it comes to the patient, similar to the skin, I use a preparation solution. I'll wash their skin down to make sure to reduce the amount of bacteria or microbes on the surface of the skin so they can't get into the body itself. During the procedure itself, at the end of it, I'll wash it out with a solution to try to reduce the amount of bacteria within the wound. And sometimes we even add antibiotics to the wound in some cases to reduce that likelihood. When I close the wound, I like to use antibacterial sutures or antimicrobial sutures, I apologize. And the reason I like to do so is because I want to keep out the bacteria as much as possible. And they do have good killing power to the bacteria that could get into the joint itself. And at the end, I like to put a nice occlusive dressing or a closed dressing on the skin so that patients can't pick at their wounds. Or again, the bacteria from the skin can't get into the wound itself and try to protect the wound and protect the patient from getting surgical site infections. So it's a team effort. That's the big thing I see here. We want both sides of the party really optimizing it so that the surgical site infection risk is lower.
Antimicrobial sutures, aren't they standard practice? Why aren't all surgeons doing what you seem to be doing?
It's a good question. I think part of it's education, part of it is availability and asking for it. Mm-hmm. It's one of those things where, you know, antimicrobial sutures alone won't prevent an entire infection.
Okay.
But why not put as much possible to try to reduce the risk of it? So I think part of it's surgeon education. If they can learn about it, then they can ask for it and use it.
Was there something that happened in your career to prompt you to be so interested in SSIs?
So as a first year intern, when I was in residency, I was interested in doing a project. We always are encouraged to do research projects, and they had a research project that was left over from a previous resident that hadn't been completed on infection. And I knew nothing about infection at that time frame. So they hand me the project and they say, can you finish this up? So I started looking into it, and I found the topic fascinating because, one, it's not a topic that we have completely eradicated. You know, by now you would hope that we'd have no infections at all whatsoever with all of our advances in antibiotics and prevention and everything. We still get them. The nice thing about it, what I find interesting about infection, is that there's still more work to be done in a good way. And that way we can prevent infection as we're talking now. And as coming up with more and more ways to prevent infection, we can prevent it from happening. You know, so things that we're looking at are things like vitamin D supplementation or irrigating with specific solutions, you know, and in the phase of treatment, you know, can I increase the use of things like antimicrobial sutures because myself, I use it, my colleagues can use it, and can we reduce infection? So I became very interested in studying infection because I wanted to do something that could impact my patients, their lives, and hopefully make it better for the next generation.
Doctor, I understand that you've touched on many points, what the patients can do, how the facility is involved. You've got five helpful tips. Can you run those through for us real quick?
I like lists and I like numbers. We always do a checklist when we do a timeout. So lists are my ways to go. So five tips and tricks on reducing or preventing surgical site infections are, just like we said right now, a surgical safety checklist is great, or an environmental cleaning protocols. If you protocolize things and you make it standard of care, these tools can allow surgeons and the hospital team to manage surgical site risk factors more proactively. So voice concerns if you see a break in this, like sterilization or a break in protocol, so then correct the error immediately so you can prevent surgical site infections. The second thing I would say is to mitigate risks where nurses and surgeons have control by cleaning hands often with alcohol-based products. For example, in joint replacements, we're very, very careful about minimizing the amount of traffic in the operating room and wear scrubs that are laundered by the facility and changing. Some facilities have you come in a suit or some business attire, change in the hospital, and you need to leave in that suit so they can see that. The third thing would be to develop surgical site prevention strategies. And you want to share this information with patients prior to surgery, especially if they or their family have previously experienced a surgical site infection. And again, we've touched on those here too as well, where we want to talk to patients prior to surgery and optimize their medical conditions, optimize their home environment so they have the cleanest possible environment to recover in. The fourth would be for nurses and surgeons or those in the healthcare field, know your options. So, example, we talked about antimicrobial sutures. There's the Ethicon's Plus antibacterial sutures. And it's the only commercially available suture that can prevent a persistent risk from the surgical equation by removing the incidence of surgical site infections. So if we can reduce the risk of surgical site infections and the power's in our hands, then I would highly encourage people to do so. And finally, the fifth one is to provide an extra layer of protection against life-altering or even fatal infections. We talked about mortality. So you can get you can lead to death when you get surgical site infections. So how do you create an occlusive dressing? For example, using Ethicon's Prineo dressing. And you can also use Ethicon's antibacterial sutures at the skin surface to, again, reduce the rate of bacteria at the surface.
And obviously, all of these precautions would preclude any challenges that the COVID-19 pandemic might present as well.
I think COVID-19 made patients really, really heightened about the awareness of infection and how infection can be super dangerous. You know, in the past, I think we would say, oh, you just get a cold, that's okay, or you just get the flu, that's okay. Well, you know, these super versions of these super contagious diseases can lead to death. And so I think it really heightened people's awareness of cleanliness, for example. I mean, how many times have we like cleaned our groceries or been more careful than we have in the past? And interestingly, we've actually noticed patients were less sick during the pandemic, as in, you know, those who didn't get COVID, there'd be less colds, for example, right? Because people were wearing masks, people were, you know, washing their hands with alcohol-based materials and things like that. So that was good. I think it's brought us awareness that when I bring up infection to my patients now, they really get it and they want to prevent it as much as possible.
Well, Dr. Chen, it's been a pleasure speaking with you this evening. Thank you so much. And hopefully we'll speak again in the future.
Fantastic. It was great to meet you.
You've been listening to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neil Howard, in conversation with Dr. Antonia Chen. Audio copies of this program are available at hpr.fm and healthprofessionalradio.com.au. You can also subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, listen in, download at SoundCloud, and be sure and subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/healthprofessionalradio.